Hi everyone, welcome to yet another episode of Building It Up with Bertelsmann, India's first podcast that focuses on the growth pangs of a startup. I am Ankur Variku, your host, and with me today is a fascinating individual, someone who's taken the China investment ecosystem by storm, Annabelle Long. Annabelle today is Bertelsmann Asia Investments founding and managing partner, but what I find interesting about her is she wasn't an investor all through. She in fact started her career as a TV anchor, became a producer with a variety of highly rated award-winning television and radio programs in China, and joined Bertelsmann in New York in 2005. She has an MBA degree from the Stanford Graduate School of Business, a bachelor's degree from the University of Electronic Science and Technology in China. But what is truly fascinating about her is her investment record. In 10 years, Annabelle has seen 20 exits, 8 IPOs, and 10 unicorns. How does that happen? In today's episode, we're going to talk about Annabelle's journey, the big India-China startup debate, the differences, the similarities, and what I hope to take away from this is how does China really make it happen? And what is there for Indian startup founders to learn from them? Thank you so much, Annabelle, for joining us all the way from China. It's a pleasure to have you on today's show.
My pleasure.
Great. Annabelle, you've had what I would call inarguably an extremely envious history as an investor for 10 years. You've spent a fascinating time in China, perhaps in the best possible period that China witnessed and is yet to come forward as well. So what we will do today is spend a lot of time with you in trying to understand how did you as an investor think of the China internet market as it was unfolding 10 years back to what you see today. And hopefully in the conversation, we'll be able to draw some parallels to what the Indian story is. So let me start with my first question. When you started 10 years back, China was not what it is today. Today, almost everything that China starts seems to become $1 billion overnight. But back then, I would imagine that things were not as rosy. They were still very hard. It still wasn't very clear what would work and what not. What was your going-in hypothesis when you joined the investing community in China 10 years back? How did you think of the industry back then?
Well, that was really green. That was my nearly first job upon graduation from Stanford GSB, where Silicon Valley teaches you the typical venture investment mindset before I joined Bertelsmann. Then things is just getting so much more interesting for China, as you remember, 10, 15 years ago. It's becoming a rather active market. But a lot of the concepts are copied originally from U.S. So back then, one of the major investment theses was called CPC, C2C, copy to China. I actually commuting between New York and Beijing a lot, trying to figure out was there a real gap or the opportunity for China to really capture by really executing this concept and really apply the U.S. kind of a financing methodology, innovation matrix, and technology trend to make it in one of the biggest market in the world. That was the original idea. I came back to China and in already 2008 to officially start BAI. Yes, that was new to the investment community, but entire investment community was really new. Even on global basis, I think no one actually had over 3 decades of investing history claimed to be any venture capitalist. Everybody is in a try and error learning mood. For China, it's even more true. For me, it's really re-entering into local market, learning a fast-changing environment. Also try to apply the U.S. concept to local market with understanding China is unique but increasingly global, market with a lot of commonalities shared with the other side of the world. The timing for us was kind of fortunately ideal, given we started to set up the fund in 2008 and here comes the financial crisis in 2009. Yeah. The market became really quiet. Nobody is investing. But the basic internet concept, the portals, the search engines, the communities are there. And the second wave coming to local services, in the same time in the U.S., you have Craigslist and you have Auto Trader, you have other counterparts ready. Facebook was still a very young company. Google just went public in 2004. So everything is new in both markets. Everybody was green. So I didn't feel I was too late to the game, although there are already some quite big companies, but not to the dominant positions as of today. So that's the situation. For us, the difficulty is really to explain to the market who we are, why we are uniquely positioned, what's our interest, what's our investment thesis, how we're going to bring a different value to the table. We actually made a lot of introductory meetings to the new community to explain we're determined really to work with local entrepreneurs to fund originated innovations from China market. We are focusing on supporting Chinese entrepreneurs on the driving seat to take the companies to next level, and we'll be really supportive, you know, cooperative, open-minded to invest beyond a typical stereotype of media conglomerate-backed venture fund in their narrowly defined areas. So this is going to be technology, this is going to be distribution platform, this is going to be next generation of media, means community and UGC-driven, really interactive community versus broadcasting man-size. Plus, we really emphasize a lot innovation, also the lifestyle changing items that's relevant, important to the Chinese population versus our subjective preference. So that takes a lot of time for people to understand what we want to do. Only after we made the first a few investments and our portfolios became our spokesperson. So they know our style, our stage, our preference, our industry interest is really not just from top down. It's really bottom up, very honest analysis to see what will be the mega trend, what will be China's advantage, what will be the unique, interesting approach for the Chinese entrepreneurs really to start a company and taking them to the next level. I don't know if the lengthy answer really fits your first question.
No, it's a fascinating response because in it is a wonderful story. I got so many things coming in from it. Thank you so much for that elaborate response. What I picked early on in your response, Annabelle, was the C2C concept, copy to China. And it's been spoken about a lot, where for a long time, people felt that China was just copying most of the established American business models. And I hear you say that while that was the genesis of what the China internet story came to be, there was a fair bit of localization in its execution. Can you spend some time on that?
Yes, sure. And I love to spend time on this topic with more details because it's no longer true, or it's never true. I was saying the C2C was a concept. People thought about really to get influence from the United States, more the Silicon Valley typical model. I would say it's more about just aspiration for a concept stage, but it comes to deep execution in terms of localization, sometimes change the game nearly completely, change the product differently, change the position, you know, just in a significant way. Now I think China became an innovation center and lab for the entire world. One of our current investment thesis will be China-based global companies.
Wow.
Even back then, on surface, people will think easily to fund U.S. comps on capital market to see Baidu is the Chinese version of Google. So Tencent is the Chinese version of Facebook. Or actually Alibaba plus JD will be the equivalent to eBay or Amazon. Actually, since the very beginning, it's actually different in many, many ways. So Tencent is not just instant messaging powered social network only. It became a very sophisticated ecosystem. Alibaba coming from a different infrastructure, they invented payment. They actually developed a different incentive system for the merchants. And JD actually focused on distribution, somehow similar to Amazon. But if you really analyze into underneath the skin, you will find fundamental difference and DNA from very beginning for the two companies. Even Baidu is the closest to Google. But it takes a lot of execution. The business model is different. It's a sales-driven, you know, B2B organization, and they actually have a different approach than Google, purely product technology driven. So from a product, from an organization structure, from an execution, from culture, many things are different. And after so many years, they actually surface to be noticed. And when you see those Chinese companies became multi-dollar, $100 billion market cap later, you will pay more respect really to do more research about their fundamental secret sauce for success, and really to understand how they are built up differently. And also because you actually notice the other companies, many of the unicorns in startup, like the Xiaomi's, like the Toutiao's, like Meituan, like the recent phenomenon on the shared bicycle. Right. Before, you know, you had a BD actually in rival against the Uber in this space. It's really hard to find a comp. Or it's really hard to decide which one start from which side of the world earlier. Yeah. It's a similar time to really start. It's even highly possible copied from China to the States, especially when it comes to next generation retail, plus any consumer-facing, community-driven, live streaming, broadcasting things that are coming actually from China. But many people thought it's just happening recently because we accumulated so much talent, we have so much experience building in the consumer-facing internet space, and now China started to innovate. China became a very important source of innovation to export to the rest of the world, given several reasons. Number one, it is the most advanced, at least the biggest consumer-facing internet community with over 1 billion smartphones and 700 smartphone users on a very active basis. So that big data really give you the capability to handle high volume of consumer experience, concurrent users, and then also really to give you the most valuable, richest data to see what's going to be popular or not. Yeah. You have a much better predictability. And thirdly, because the transparency on a global basis is especially for younger generation, you share more commonality rather than the so-called culture difference. They follow the same celebrity, same Hollywood movie, same game on a global basis.
Yeah.
Then what's popular in China will have much higher chance really to success, to succeed beyond Chinese border. And also because China has the talent base, which India also has similar advantages, the young working force, the highly efficient and talented engineers at a much lower cost of producing amazing consumer products with no labels made in China, because that's internet products, to be executed, that's amazing. Lastly, I think the beautiful detail will be, in the U.S. there's a religion. If the product is good, it kills everything. But in China, we always emphasize internet experience is about superb consumer experience. It cannot just be good, it has to be great. You shouldn't just serve people, you have to spoil your consumer, your user. So it's always not just one magical product, it has to be a superb product coupled with brilliant services, fast response, and constant change. So right now, if you look at the top 20 internet companies on a global basis, it's basically divided between China and the U.S., evenly divided.
I so agree with you. That is absolutely bang on, Annabelle. And I think the biggest shift that's happened in the last 10 years is China has moved from being what I would call a secondary internet market to perhaps the most primary internet market that the world has. It has the biggest consumer base. It has talent that's unparalleled. And it's followed a consumer service approach that, as you rightly pointed out, is super focused on following the user and not just dependent on product-led startups, which do some magic someday to make it all work. Couldn't agree more. I had a follow-up question, Annabelle, to this. China is now fast becoming the biggest source of innovation in the world and also the biggest source of capital that is flowing in into startups. And India particularly has witnessed a lot of Chinese-based investors and China-based companies investing significant amounts of money in the market. Do you see this trend as a long-term trend? Do you see both investors and companies from China looking at markets such as India for a sustained period of time? And if yes, then what are the attributes of the Indian market that you would think appeal to the Chinese counterparts, whether investors or companies?
Absolutely. This is a very important trend for every investor to follow. I always say there will be no concept called Asia. They're important countries, and they are so different. It's China, India, Japan, three countries in Asia, and they cannot be more different. But India actually share a lot characteristics, and many people believe that's the next horizon to arise for its very energetic young population, for its changing regime, better governance of the political system, for its determination, and for its democracy and the freedom to give all the possibilities. And this is really also very, very big. And the fastest growing economy now in the world is on GDP measurement.
Yeah.
It reminds people a lot, like China 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
But if there is another opportunity to come, given the development of technology and the openness of the global community, everything will be even faster. So based on the China experience, many people, including the Chinese investors, benefited, rewarded, actually from the last 2 decades of wealth creation. No one can afford to ignore Indian market. We have to be there, and we have to see what can be done in Indian market in an even efficient and effective way, and to by applying technology know-how from the learnings through investing into China and other emerging markets. But maybe China is still the most relevant example for Indian market.
Right.
And Indian is also very diverse, with a lot of languages and different religions and groups. Somehow quite similar to China as well, but China's advantage is one single language. India will be more challenging in terms of infrastructure still lagging behind.
Yeah.
The languages, and so the leapfrogging was the key word for China in the past 2 decades. I guess this is probably will be happening to India as well, and especially the companies that grow that way. It is witnessed those experienced phenomena, including Baidu, Alibaba, Tencent themselves, cannot afford to really lose the next growth driver. They're all actually committed to look into opportunity in Indian market. And as I noticed, they're already making a lot active investments into the market, becoming a notable force in India's investment community. I don't know if that's true. And also you have active companies already regard India as the most important international market.
Mm.
We talk about, as I said, China-based global company. India has to be one of the most important international markets for the Chinese companies. We actually have two portfolios, for example, one called Beagle. Our single largest international market, number one, is India.
Wow.
And we have another e-commerce company ranked number 3 in India called Club Factory.
Oh.
India markets account for 90% of our revenue source.
Wow.
And we have another indirect but very, very famous portfolio called Xiaomi. It's going to public now.
Yeah.
I guess it's quite popular consumer brand now.
It's the number one smartphone brand in India.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Know that. Good to hear from you.
Yeah. It's a phenomenal success, absolutely.
Yeah, that's how important India is to us, and also given the proxy, the cultural similarity, I think the Chinese company will feel if they don't pay enough attention to Indian market, there will be already a strategic failure.
Wow.
For both investors and any corporation thinking a global perspective, India will be the most important market.
Wonderful. That's music to our ears. Thank you so much for that. On the other side, Annabelle, there are several Indian startups that are looking at international markets, and usually the first reaction of a mature international market would be the US. But what's changed remarkably in the last few years is China is being seriously considered as one of the markets Indian startups, particularly software as service companies, could consider. it's also not an easy market to crack, and there are enough stories of people not having succeeded in China, particularly from India. According to you, being a sound investor in the Chinese market, having worked with local entrepreneurs for a decade, what would be your few pieces of advice to startups based out of India who are looking to scale in China or Southeast Asia in general?
Well, I think you definitely want to understand what's your core competency and be confident about that and focus on what you're best at. And don't compete that against, something you need to catch up. Really to understand the importance, possibly, of partnership. To really find a local partner, I think that's important. When enter into a market, you really have to respect to the local environment in terms of regulation, the local culture, not in a very cliche way, but really how the entrepreneurs are working, what's the working attitude to your employees, and how do you recruit in the market, and how do you work with your partners. Sometimes this is really not about, like, stereotype of the Chinese will be really more aggressive than Japanese, and Japanese will be just more polite. They are very subtle in terms of expressing their ideas. It's much more practical than that. It's hard to describe, but don't read any typical book. There's still a type of written about so-called culture difference. You have to understand that this is a global community. And as a startup, you mainly are dealing with very young, energetic companies and people. Just go there to feel it, to really have a sense and impression by yourself, to see what's your expectation from your partners, and are you bringing any value to the table? Are you making a unique contribution? Really, it's not seek for help or advice. It's really to find a complementary way to work together. I think that's important starting point. Then just to leverage on your best competence to see how you really can break into one killer application into a new market. I think that's also more important. That will be my personal feeling. It's the strongest point I'm trying to make. But I do think India companies will have a advantage in many regards. One is English speaking capability. I think that's important in a rather international environment. Southeast Asia, many countries actually do that. U.S. market is really hard to penetrate.
Yeah.
Also given the established, but versus in China market, there's a lot of things are still new. And the government is taking, I'm not really promoting the propaganda, but it's true. Given in many industries, everything is new, so the regulators will wait and see to see once you get there and what should be corrected. So that's rather practical in my side for startups to do better. And you mentioned the sector. Enterprise services, especially IPO, has been a tradition, very strong tradition for Indian companies. It's becoming a very important theme now for all the Chinese companies. They have been enjoying the growth past 10 years. Now when the competition comes to the next phase, they really need to focus on not just the top-line growth, but also the efficiency in terms of managing costs in many regards. So we'll only notice now enterprise services is becoming an important area of attention for the Chinese companies. In this regard, I would say India have a lot. India has a lot of advantages in track record credibility, maybe through certain distribution partners or maybe even through equity joint venture. We'll really find the partner to work together with you for the localization can probably advance your success early on.
Good. China today is home to inarguably the world's biggest internet conglomerates, Baidu, Alibaba, Tencent, BAT as we call it. And it's been seen that there are a lot of startups that are growing up in their shadows. They are either very quickly taking an equity into those companies or are building competitors to successful startups that are starting up. What has been your experience? How do small startups who are trying to make it big in China compete with the BAT phenomena?
Okay, I wouldn't completely agree this is really in the shadow. Well, you can say this is a very interesting ecosystem if the companies are going to be this big. When you talk about Alibaba and Tencent, they became ecosystem building company, meaning by definition, many multi-billion dollar companies can build upon their infrastructure. So there are already pretty good examples of, new retailers and payment companies, consumer finance companies, and they were majority owned by either Alibaba or Tencent, or they actually took just a stake by Alibaba or Tencent, but with the resources and capital they injected, they could grow even better. So they are very successful examples. Tencent alone, I think, is holding a portfolio with 600 to 800 companies, depends on size, but I think that's the number. So they are deeply participating through portfolio approach into really growing the entire internet ecosystem or local services system or new retail or finance, many sectors. They're putting a lot of resources behind. I wouldn't be so naive to say there will be no challenges. Certainly, you're competing against Alibaba and Tencent's business units, their products, their features. Even one single change on one feature can kill one startup if you're with Tencent, right? Yeah. But still, that gives better companies opportunities to grow to be even big. And smaller companies definitely will feel a lot of intensified competition. But in general, I think the mindset when they come to this stage is too big to fail. They have to, and they have already changed their attitude to be ecosystem building companies to empower.
No, that makes sense. Totally. I had a follow-up question. I've always been intrigued about this. I get the impression that China is an extremely competitive market when it comes to startups in general, but the competition is very healthy. It gives me the impression that entrepreneurs, even if they're competing, tend to help each other. Is that true? And if that is true, how much of this do you feel has contributed to building the ecosystem?
The competition is bloody. China is their jungle. It requires entrepreneur to understand everything. So I already shared with you, it's not enough just to have a talent for product. You really have to be a general, to be a king. You really know how to defend your kingdom. You have to be a strategist. You have to be a warrior. You have to be a fighter. You have to be a lion and a frog at the same time. So it requires very sophisticated, comprehensive skill sets. That's a lot for entrepreneur really to conquer, to achieve, to face, to be challenged every day.
Awesome.
I would say it's maybe the most challenging market.
Wonderful.
I have to be really honest.
Great. Yeah. I don't think you could have summarized this well. Wonderful. Thank you so much, Annabelle. This has been lovely. Thank you for your time. I know it's a busy day for you, but you were gracious with your time and we couldn't have asked for more.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Wonderful. Have a good day, Annabelle. Take care. And with this, we come to the end of yet another amazing episode of Building It Up with Bertelsmann. I loved my conversation with Annabelle. There was just so much to take away, and I hope you thoroughly enjoyed this as much as I did. Until the next episode, this is Ankur Variku, your host, signing off. Have a good week, everyone.